name is Shannon. I work at the museum. I'm going to introduce our speaker tonight. Our Gregory Nokes, our speaker tonight, has traveled the world as a reporter and editor. He is author of two nonfiction Northwest histories, Massacred for Gold, The Chinese in Hell's Canyon, and his newest book, which we're going to talk about tonight, Breaking Chains, Slavery on Trial in the Oregon Territory. Both are published by the Oregon State University Press. Breaking Chains tells the little-known history of slavery in early Oregon, focusing on an 1852 slavery case, Holmes v. Ford, the only slavery case adjudicated in Oregon courts. Greg's book was a finalist for the 2014 Oregon Book Award for Nonfiction. Prominent Northwest author Jane Kirkpatrick has said, "This is how history should be written." His 2009 book, Massacred for Gold, tells the story of the 1887 massacre of nearly three dozen Chinese gold miners in Hell's Canyon on the Oregon-Idaho border. The book is now in its fourth printing. Greg spent more than 40 years in journalism, during which he traveled to more than 50 countries. As a reporter in Washington, D.C. for the Associated Press, he covered the State Department and traveled with several presidents and secretaries of states on foreign visits. He started his career as a reporter with the Medford Mail Tribune and finished at the Oregonian, where he was both an editor and reporter. He retired from journalism in 2003 to embark on a second career as an author and lecturer on Northwest history. Greg is nearing completion of a biography of Peter Burnett, who led the first major wagon train to Oregon in 1843 and later was first elected governor of California. A native of Oregon, Greg did his undergraduate work at Willamette University. He attended Harvard University as a Nieman Fellow in 1971-72. Greg and his wife, Candace, live in West Lynn.
I'm a native Oregonian, but I'm just telling somebody, I've never been independent before.
It's about time, huh?
And this actually was kind of the center of much of the activity that I was writing about, because of a lot of Missouri settlers came and settled in this part of the country. So I always like to tell you how I got into this story. I had written this book, Massacred for Gold, and as Shannon said, it's now in its fourth printing. It's done very well. In fact, tonight, Oregon Experience is doing a half-hour program inspired by this book. I got my DVR set, so I can watch it, you know. But I wanted to do another book, and so I had some ideas, and I bounced these off of my brother Bill one day, and he kind of dismissed each one politely and said, "Why don't you write about Reuben Shipley?" He said, "Who was Reuben Shipley?" Said he was a slave brought to Oregon by one of our ancestors. Well, I had no idea. I didn't think there were any black slaves ever in Oregon. I had no idea that our family was connected in any way with slavery. Most of the family came from Iowa in 1853, but there was an element who came from Missouri, and one of those fellows had slaves in Missouri and brought one of them out here. Robert Shipley was his name. So this sent me then on my mission for this next book. And in the course of that, I discovered a trial in 1852 called Holmes versus Ford that I will talk about tonight. And I was kind of blown away by the discovery that there was such a trial. I had no idea there was ever slaves in Oregon, but that there was actually a slavery trial. And so that kind of became the focus of this book. And so I have some slides. I'd like to show some of those. And I will talk about the family that brought the slaves out, some of the people around that time, and try to keep them choking too badly here. I'll try to project. So you can see can you all see this all right up here? Is it moving? It's okay.
Can you bring it in here?
Pardon?
Want me to lower the lights?
Yeah. Yes.
Give them a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, good.
So Fayette is aren't here on, marked here on from Fayette, Missouri, because that's where a fellow came from who brought the Holmes family out here as slaves. But that's the Oregon Trail, of course, and this is the Dalles, where the wagon train sort of broke up, but both the destination for most of Oregon City, as you know. And a fellow I'm going to talk about settled Rick Rio, and my relative settled in the Philomath area. This is Nathaniel and his wife. Nathaniel Ford in Missouri was quite a prominent Missourian. He was a member of the Missouri legislature, four-time county sheriff, had a lot of slaves, probably as many as 15 slaves. But in 1837, there was something called the Panic of 37, which was a depression. So a lot of landowners in Missouri and elsewhere lost their land. And so he took advantage of a proposal by Senator Lynn and others to provide free land to anybody who would come across the country. And so we can go into that later if you want, but this was taken in Oregon after he got here. And in Oregon, he became very prominent as well. He was a 5-time member of the territorial legislature, and he was a slave owner. This is a home in near Dallas, no longer exists there. But I picked this up at the Oregon Historical Society, and you can't see the caption that's at the top here. It identifies this as a Ford home with slave quarters in the back. You can't really see those, but it's the only picture we have. And there were slave quarters back here. So this is present day Rickreall, and virtually this entire town is on a property that was once part of Nathaniel Ford's donation land claim. This is Peter Burnett, not Marlon Brando. And he plays a role in the story. Not only did he lead the first major wagon train out in 1843, but he became a member of the first elected legislative council in Oregon, was responsible for the first exclusion law and the lash law that accompanied that. And this is the lash law, and this is subsection 6. So if you're not familiar with that particular law, Oregon in its early history, during most of its early history, had in place an exclusion law which banned African Americans from coming. There was 3 of them during this period. This one lasted about a year, and then it was changed by Jesse Applegate, who had different ideas about humanity. But this was what it read, that if any such a free Negro or mulatto shall fail to quit the country as required by this act, he or she may be arrested upon a warrant issued by some justice of the peace, and if guilty upon trial before such justice, shall receive upon his or her bare back not less than 20 or more than 39 stripes to be inflicted by the constable of the proper county. And this was enacted on June 18, 1844, and it was changed a year later. But there were similar exclusion laws, but not lash laws, in 1849 that lasted until 1854, and of course was written into the Oregon Constitution as well, and we'll get back to that in a minute. And then as a little aside, Peter Burnett eventually ended up in California. He went down to the mine gold, got himself elected the first governor of California, and he tried repeatedly to get the California legislature to pass an exclusion law, but it wouldn't pass it, and he eventually resigned for other reasons. This is Reuben Boyce, and I want to stop here because this is a time to talk a little bit about the Holmes family and what happened with them. So to give you a little background, there was Robin Holmes, his wife, I'm going to say Harriet, I'm not quite sure that's right, I'm not remembering. It was Robin Holmes, his wife, and they had 4 children, and they came out with Nathaniel Ford. He actually brought the 6-7 slaves. He also brought a male named Scott out with him. And so Oregon had this law, which Burnett had passed, which allowed slaveholders up to 3 years to hold their slaves in Oregon before they had to free them. That was my second major surprise. My first major surprise was there were slaves at all. The second major surprise was it actually was lawful to hold slaves for up to 3 years. Had no idea. Anyway, the Holmeses came out in 1844 in the second major wagon train. Nathaniel Ford led that wagon train himself. Settled at Rickreall, as I said. And then by 1850, 6 years had gone by, Holmes was still holding the Ford family and Scott as slaves on his property down at Rickreall. Well, there's a certain amount of agitation among abolitionists going on in Oregon at the time. There's a lot of pressure on Ford to release the slaves.
So Holmes and his wife, Holmes petitioned to Ford, appealed to him for his freedom, and Ford made a deal with him. Said, you go to California and mine gold, you and Scott, and I'll give your freedom when you get back. Well, he did that. Sadly, Scott died in an accident on the way back, but Holmes did come back, and Ford did give him his freedom, he and his wife his freedom, but he kept their children. And so that then became the argument for this trial. And to go quickly to Ford's position, it was, well, I brought these children out across country when they were little, too small to do anything constructive. I raised them, fed them, clothed them, put a roof over their head. Now that they're old enough to do some work, I'm entitled to some of their labor, so I kept them. And then Holmes, who was really one of the most courageous people in Oregon, if you stop and think about it, brought a suit against Robin, Nathaniel Ford for the freedom of his children. One of the children had died, probably in Ford's custody. Harriet's death in 1851, that was one of the children, seems to have galvanized Robin Holmes into taking action against Ford. Two of his children were dead, a small one had died previously, and he and his wife had little hope of ever being reunited with their three children in Missouri. I did mention that when Ford had to sell off some of his slaves in Missouri before he ever came out, three children were sold there, older ones, before he ever left. And as you know from your history, it wasn't unusual for families to be divided like that. Slave owners paid little attention to families. On April 16, 1852, Holmes filed for a writ of habeas corpus in Second District Court in Polk County to require Ford to appear in court with Holmes' three children to explain why he was holding them. Holmes' subsequent testimony would strongly suggest he blamed Ford for Harriet's death and wanted to rescue the other children before something happened to them. How Holmes came to file a suit is a matter of conjecture. Was he encouraged by a friend, a neighbor, perhaps someone who had witnessed his despair? At the time of Holmes' suit, there were no laws in Oregon prohibiting African Americans from filing a suit or testifying against whites. But as a result of this case, the legislature very quickly enacted such a law that blacks could not testify against whites or bring suits against them. We know Holmes was someone who stood up for himself and his family, but think of the odds. He had lived his life as a slave, raised in a slave culture, bought and sold at the whim of others, unable to read or write. He was up against a powerful man with powerful connections, recently elected to the territorial legislature. Yet despite all, Holmes was a risk taker. This would be evident again years later when he and his wife would be among a handful of African Americans, all former slaves, who integrated a white church in Salem. That was a Salem Congregational Church, and this story is an important part of their history. Prior to bringing his suit, Holmes had had several angry exchanges with Ford over custody of Holmes' children. Most likely these occurred at Ford's home. We don't know what was said, but we might guess how they started. Did Holmes arrive on foot or by wagon to confront Ford, who after a shouting match ordered Holmes to leave? Was it during one of these arguments that Ford threatened to seize the entire Holmes family under the New Fugitive Slave Act and return them to slavery in Missouri? And we know he made that threat because that came out during the trial. Did Holmes go in anger and frustration directly from Ford's home to the Polk County Courthouse, a new two-story wood building in Dallas, and then run unannounced into the prosecuting attorney's office to seek help? If so, he may well have been greeted with curiosity, even suspicion. Here was a black man, possibly ill-dressed in work clothes, covered with dust from the grist mill. He was free by this time and had a job in James Nesmith's grist mill. He was unable to write his own name and probably knowing little or nothing about legal procedures. One can imagine a clerk trying to shoo him away, ignoring the man's simple plea to help him get his children back. Someone then or earlier or later did take him in hand. That someone was Reuben Boyce, a prosecuting attorney for the Oregon Territory. A native of Massachusetts and a graduate of Williams College, Boyce arrived in Oregon in 1851. He was one of those that came by ship. It would be easy to romanticize a possible scene in Boyce's office. While sitting at his desk on a warm afternoon in early spring, he hears Holmes pleading for help and resisting the clerk's attempts to get him to leave. At 31 years of age, Boyce is new in his position, appointed prosecuting attorney only weeks earlier by the territorial legislature. He is from Massachusetts, a hotbed of abolitionist sentiment. This could be his first case, an important one. No slavery case has yet come before Oregon's courts, nor would there be another. He lives within 10 miles of Ford's farm and no doubt knows who Ford is. Perhaps he doesn't care for Ford because he's a slave owner. Whatever it is that motivates him, he asks Holmes to come in and sit down. All that could be true, some of it true, none of it true. Boyce could have met Holmes at James Nesmith's gristmill, where Holmes worked as a laborer. Perhaps Nesmith, out of sympathy for Holmes' plight, mentioned him to Boyce. But what is certainly true is that something or someone did bring Boyce and Holmes together, and Boyce took charge of the case. A little more background on what was going on in Oregon. This is George Williams, and he would handle the case. The case dragged on for 15 months before four different judges. The first three were all either pro-slavery or didn't want to rock the boat. It was interesting, in this period of time in Oregon, many of the leaders, territorial leaders, were appointed by presidents who themselves owned slaves. I don't know if we're aware that I think it was 11 former presidents all had slaves at one point or another, including Polk, who made a number of the appointments in Oregon. Buchanan wasn't a slaveholder, but he was very sympathetic to the South. He also made a number of these appointments. So you had pro-slavery people in positions of leadership. The great populace was not necessarily pro-slavery, but by and large, they were anti-black. Many of them came from Missouri. They had experienced the slave culture. Many of them didn't have slaves, but they had what they felt unfair competition from those who did have slaves. And so it was a movement to keep slaves out of Oregon. Of course, Burnett was playing to that. He shared that he'd had two slaves himself as a younger man. So the first three judges kind of dismissed the case, kept kicking the can down the road. And then finally in 1852, Franklin Pierce, who was not a slaveholder, appointed George Williams, originally from New York, to be the new territorial Supreme Court judge. And Williams hadn't been here very long, and he ruled in the case. So we'll read a little bit on that ruling. This is one of the first cases that he dealt with. On July 13, 1853, Judge Williams issued the following ruling on Ford versus Holmes. I have a lot of the testimony from the trial in the book, but I'm not reading that testimony, but you can get some idea from what I've been telling you how it went. Said judge, and this is a quote from Judge Williams' ruling, said judge, having heard the allegations and evidence of the petitioner and respondent, orders and decrees that the said children, Jenny or Mary Jane, James and Roxanna, be and they hereby are awarded to the care and custody of their parents. Robin Holmes and his wife to be and remain with them as their children as fully and in all respects as though they, the said children, had not been in the custody said Ford. Some legalese, but I think you get the gist of it. He freed the children. There was hardly any attention paid to this in Oregon. It was one thing for a judge to make a ruling like that. There was probably in this period of time, probably about 35 to 50 slaves, still in custody. And I don't know that any of them were released as a result of this ruling because nobody was enforcing it. There was hardly any publicity. And it was up to Williams himself years later before the Oregon legislature to say what he felt the implications of this were. So this is from a speech he gave in 1859. whether or not slaveholders could carry their slaves into the territories and hold them there as property had become a burning question. My predecessors in office, those were the other three judges, for reasons best known to themselves, had declined to hear this case. This was among the first cases I was called upon to decide. Mr. Ford contended these colored people were his property in Missouri from which he emigrated. He had as much right to bring that kind of property into Oregon and hold it here as much as he had to bring his cattle or other property here and hold it as such. But my opinion was, and I so held, that without some positive legislative enactment establishing slavery here, it did not and could not exist in Oregon, and I awarded the colored people their freedom. So far as I know, this was the last effort made to hold slaves in Oregon by force of law. There were a great many virulent pro-slavery men in the territory, and this decision, of course, was very distasteful to them. So going a little bit into the history here, there's more to be said about this. This is one of the, another statement from his ruling, and I found this particularly interesting. Ford had said in his defense, well, I had freed the Holmes parents. And this is how Williams addressed that. To convey that to a person which at the time is absolutely his by law plainly amounts to nothing. And that was the date of the ruling, July 19, 1853. Now, Williams, interestingly enough, he had hopes of being one of the first U.S. senators from Oregon, but he was denied that. But he was later elected a U.S. senator from Oregon, went to Washington, went to work for Ulysses Grant, who appointed him U.S. Attorney General. Well, he dealt with a lot of the early KKK cases that were coming out of the South in that period. And he later nominated Williams to be Chief Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court, but Williams wasn't confirmed. This is a sketch of the old Salem Courthouse where the 1857 Constitutional Convention was held. This is Judge Matthew Deedy. His name is probably familiar to in Oregon history. He was an ardent pro-slavery person. He was president of the Constitutional Convention. At the time of the convention, there was a great division in the Democratic Party. As you know from your history, the Democratic Party was the party of slavery, at least the southern portion was. But by 1857, the party was kind of dividing, not just in Oregon, but to everywhere else, we kind of your northern wing and your southern wing. And so while there was slavery was on the table, whether Oregon legalized slavery in the Constitution, the delegates to the convention kicked it down the road and let the voters decide. But Deedy made no bones about his interest. If a citizen of Virginia can lawfully own a Negro, of which there is no doubt, then I, as a citizen of Oregon, can lawfully obtain the same right of property in this Negro by their purchase or inheritance. Matthew Deedy, July 28, 1857. Deedy, as you know, was one of the founders, or the founder, of the University of Oregon Law School and went on to a very prestigious role as U.S. District Court judge in Portland and established quite a good reputation for himself as a defender of Chinese interests, but he was not particularly kind to African Americans. So what happened? So the delegates just didn't decide on the slavery issue and decided to let voters decide. Now, I found this particularly interesting because big surprise number four, I think this was, I had no idea that Oregon had ever voted on whether or not to become a slave state. Again, the fact there was an election at all blew me away. So the Constitutional Convention submitted three proposals to voters. One, do you approve the Constitution or not? Do you approve that Oregon would be a slave state or not? Three, should African Americans be excluded from Oregon or not? So the Constitution was overwhelmingly approved. The slave state issue was overwhelmingly rejected, but the exclusion law was overwhelmingly enacted. And this is how that reads. And you'll notice the word free Negro at the top, still leaving an opening for slavery were that to happen in the future. No free Negro or mulatto not residing in this state at the time of the adoption of this Constitution shall come, reside, or be within this state, or hold any real estate, or make any contracts, or maintain any suit therein, and the Legislative Assembly shall provide by penal laws for the removal by public officers of all such Negroes and mulattoes, and for their effectual exclusion from the state, and for the punishment of persons who shall bring them into the state, or employ or harbor them. That stood in the Oregon Constitution until 1924, if I have my year right. So you can see during all this period, there's not a lot of record that any of these three, this was an exclusion law, this was a third one. There's not a lot of history to suggest that African Americans were actually excluded from the state. We know one man who became a businessman, and apparently his white competitors didn't like the fact he was in business, and so they blew the whistle on him, and he was forced to leave. Jacob Vanderpool was his name. There were a lot of white Vanderpools in Oregon, so there must have been a connection. He must have been, I'm guessing, a slave at one point of the Vanderpool family, but we've never established that fact. Anyway, we don't know what happened to him after he was forced out. There were the courts also ruled in the case of two other people that they were supposed to also had to leave the state. But by this time, the anti-slavery forces were beginning to get more supportive, and the legislature changed the law and allowed them to stay. And that, I'm trying to remember the name of these two gentlemen. There's a story in the book about them, which is pretty interesting. I won't get into that, but you'll know it when you see it. This is Joseph Lane, and he was the first territorial governor of Oregon, first U.S. senator, and a record of being pro-slavery. And we all know that Liberal Lane County is named for him, and is quite prestigious, famous in the Mexican-American War. And so there's been kind of a movement going on in Lane County to change the name of the county. That hasn't happened and probably won't, but they have changed the name and some other features down there, things that are named after people who are very, very involved in slavery. Lane's a pretty big player, and so the idea that they would, in fact, his whole support for slavery has been kind of fuzzed up, you know, so you really can't hard discern exactly what happened. But remember Andrew Johnson, the future president of the United States, said on the floor of the Senate, when Lane was in the Senate, that he was more Southern than the South itself. This is Isaac Stevens, and he was the first territorial governor of Washington. And I'm showing here because I'll tell a little story about the 1850 Democratic Convention. I think it was 1850. When was Lincoln elected? 1860 convention. So thank you. Things tend to slip after a while. The Democratic Party was divided, as I suggested earlier, in between the North and the South. And so they had their convention in Baltimore that year. And the Northern faction of the party, which was dominant at that time, wanted to nominate Stephen Douglas to be president. Douglas' own credentials on the slavery issue were a bit fuzzy, but the South did not support him, and they wanted different candidates, and so the party split, and you had your Southern delegations and held a rump convention in Richmond, and who were the delegations that joined them? California and Oregon. Interesting. Lane was sort of the leader of the Oregon Democratic Party at that time and had a role in it. And Isaac Stevens, who was the first territorial governor of Washington, not yet a state, but he was a member of the Oregon delegation of the convention, and he headed up the campaign for the Southern candidates, slave state candidates, who were Joseph Breckinridge of Kentucky and Joseph Lane of Oregon, ran for vice president. And interestingly enough, it was because the party was split between the Douglas and the Breckinridge Lane factions that the new Republican candidate was able to be elected president. And Oregon and California did vote for Lincoln narrowly, but they did. This is a picture of a few slaves, former slaves here. And I'm gonna go to my list here because my memory is fading here. This is Lewis Southworth. He was brought out from Missouri by a John Southworth in 1853. And this is a very unusual picture because there aren't many photographs of slaves from that period for all the obvious reasons. They were considered less than, and generally speaking, they were illiterate. And so photographs weren't in their family as a rule. However, some became exceptional, and Lewis Southworth was one of those. He was allowed to buy his freedom after he came out in Oregon. And I say aloud, there was nothing in Oregon law that required that a slave had to pay for his freedom. In fact, there weren't supposed to be any slaves at all. There was a law against that at the time. But Lewis Southworth wanted his freedom, and John Southworth said, $1,000, I'll give you your freedom. And so he went to work as a gold miner and played fiddles at dances, and you can see the fiddle, and paid for his freedom, self-educated, became literate, operated a livery stable somewhere in Polk County, and then went on to the coast, to present-day Lincoln County, where he operated a ferry and gained some notoriety. I find this particularly interesting. This is America, dropped it. This is America Waldo. And she came out with Daniel Waldo, who was one of the people that voted with Peter Burnett to impose the lash law and the first exclusion law. He was a slaveholder in Missouri, and there's some question whether he actually had slaves in Oregon. Descendants of the Black Waldos, one of the few former slave families that's organized, contend that Daniel Waldo did bring her out, that he was her father, that he fathered her with a slave, a woman who was a slave of his, and then he tended to raise her. Well, we do know that Daniel Waldo raised her, and we do know that he gave her away at a wedding on the Proclamation Day, and she married a free black from Jamaica, Richard Bogle, and Bogle's a famous name in Oregon politics and in the media, and they lived in Walla Walla and raised a nice family. We can come back to any of these if you have questions on it later. This is one of my favorite. This is Amanda Johnson. Quite a lovely lady. And her story is particularly interesting. She was born in Liberty, Clay County, Missouri on August 30, 1833, and arrived in Oregon in 1853 with the Anderson-Deckard family. Now, I need to pay my respects to somebody who wrote about these former slaves earlier. There was a fellow in Oregon, a reporter for the Oregon Journal, Fred Lockley, who interviewed some of the former slaves in the early part of the last century while they were still alive, including Amanda Johnson. He's the only other person I know of who took a real interest in the slave story until I came along. And many of the things that he wrote are in the files of the Oregon Historical Society, which was a major source for me in material. And he had written about that long-forgotten trial, the Holmes versus Ford. So he led me to a lot of the things that I wrote about in this book. And as somebody who's not a formal historian, it's what we do is we kind of build on what others have done, and hopefully other people come along and build on what I've done, because I don't know the full story of any of these things, but I know part of it. And there's more to be learned, and so others will come along and hopefully use my material and others' material to build on these. But anyway, I'm rambling on too much. Anyway, Fred Lockley interviewed Amanda Johnson in 1921. She lived in Albany. I'm quoting from his article, which was in the Oregon Historical Quarterly. When I asked her if she had ever been sold as a slave, she said, "No, sir, I was never sold nor bartered for. I was given as a wedding present to my owner's daughter. I belonged to Mrs. Nancy Wilhite. Mrs. Wilhite later married Mr. Corum. When her daughter, Miss Lydia, was married, she gave me to her as a wedding present. I have known 7 generations of the family. I had 5 brothers and 6 sisters. None of us were ever sold like common slaves. We were all given away as the different young folks got married. Is it sad or what? In 1853, my owners came to Oregon. A man offered my master $1,200 for me. I was 19 years old then. My owner said, Amanda isn't for sale. She is going across the plains to the Willamette Valley with us. She was like one of the family. I don't care to sell her. It took us 6 months to come from Liberty, Missouri to Oregon City. We reached our destination on September 13, 1853. Lou Southworth, also a slave, crossed the plains the same year I did. So did Benjamin Johnson, another slave who later became my husband. And sometimes in these recollections, that's just a name. It's all we have, Benjamin Johnson or Lou Southworth. And those become little clues to follow up and say, okay, well, who is that person? And then you can put a picture together. But nobody was keeping records of slaves. Nobody was keeping the history. Anyway, she said she was offered her freedom in Missouri, and she declined to accept it because she was afraid that even though she was allowed to be free in Missouri, you could see she was an attractive woman, that somebody would pick her up and once again make her a slave. So she came to Oregon, was well treated, and got her freedom. Many of the slaves who came out, I didn't say this earlier, were freed within the first few years. Many of them had an understanding with their owners, the males in particular. You helped me get my farm started, and I'll give you your freedom. And that was the case for most of them, but certainly not all, not in the case of the Holmes family with Robin Ford. So this is Ben Johnson. This is Amanda Johnson later years on your right, and Ben Johnson on the left. And he obviously was also given his freedom at some point. We don't know much more about him except the year he came out and that he did become her husband. This is the Oddfellows Cemetery in Corvallis. I find this interesting because there is this great marker, Amy, a slave of Mary and John Porter. I find this pretty interesting for several reasons. One, there are very few markers for slaves. I understand there is one for Letitia Carson somewhere. I don't know. Have you seen it?
Not yet.
Yeah, I'm told there is one. And then this is one, probably the only other one that exists. And it's interesting because obviously she was well thought of enough to include her in the family plot with her own grave marker, but not well thought enough, you know, to leave off the fact that she was a slave. They had to put that on the grave marker that she was a slave. And the third thing to learn about this was by this time, I've got the exact year of her death, like 1865, something like that, but she'd been publicly a slave even while slavery was illegal nationally. In Linn County, in fact, in the 1860 census, by this time slavery was illegal, there were 2 people down there who listed their slaves as slaves on the census, the Oregon census. It's interesting, I've seen the original census takers lists to know that that's true. But what's interesting is by the time that reached the state, and then by the time it reached the federal government, Oregon is listed as having no slaves. Because obviously the people who received this information said, slavery is supposed to be illegal, we can't put this in there. So they just ignored it. This is George Washington, and he came out as a free African American. And his story is interesting because he came out during one of the exclusion laws, the 1853 exclusion law, and he came out with his white former owner. He was from Maryland, but he was freed by the time he came here. And the former owner did not want to live south of the border because the exclusion law really applied only in what was Oregon, even though Washington was generally part of the Oregon Territory. In Washington, it was not applied. And so they located up there where would not be excluded. And he became considered the father of Centralia, Washington. He had a large farm up there. There's a marker in the city park up there for him. Now, I don't want you to laugh when I tell you this fellow's name, but it was George Bush. Keep in mind, it was George Bush before George Bush. So he was a wealthy African American, free African American, who came out to Oregon with a party of some white friends. And he helped them. He had money and helped them to come out. But he also settled north of the border. Now, his story is also in the book. But just briefly, he was told on the way out that it would be some threat to you if you settle south of the border because Oregon has exclusion law. And so he also diverted north of the border and located near present-day Olympia, Washington. Bush Prairie happens to be named for him. Became very prominent up there. In fact, this was the home that he had. It's no longer there, but you can get some idea from the home of the wealth that the man must have had. That family has all become white. He had come out with a white wife, and I believe he had 8 sons, all of whom, when they got to Washington, I understand, also married white women, and so that Negro blood just disappeared into a Caucasian race. And of course, there was nothing to be gained by being an African American at that time. And so if you could whiten yourself up, sad as it is to say, this was an attractive option for them. Life would be better. Now, you've seen pictures of the owner of the Holmes family. You've seen pictures of the attorney who represented them in the suit. You've seen pictures of the judge who decided the case. This is the only photograph we have of any of the Holmes family. This was Mary Jane Holmes, who was 10 at the time that the case was decided in 1853. And this photograph was taken in 1821, shortly before her death. And, excuse me, 1920. Thank you. I appreciate corrections like that. Being a former journalist, you can slip up. Anyway, 1921, and this was taken in a rest home that she had, she was living in. So it's just sad, you know, that's the Holmes figured so prominently in Oregon history. It was their case which really determined once and for all that slavery was unlawful in Oregon. They helped to integrate a white church, which was very, very notable. Robin Holmes was illiterate in a community basically hostile to blacks, and yet he had all this achievement and scarcely remembered. So I'm coming back to my story. You might remember I started out by saying Reuben Shipley, a black slave, was brought out by one of my ancestors from Missouri. Well, Reuben probably got his freedom right away. I don't think he ever became literate, but he became a hardworking farmer and established a farm for himself. And he wanted a wife. Now, he left his wife, had to leave his wife and 2 sons in Missouri because they had different owners and he was not able to bring them out. And it had been his intention, according to the family story, that he had planned to make money and bring them here to live in Oregon with him, but his wife had died, and for whatever reason, he didn't bring his 2 sons out. They didn't want to come, or he couldn't locate them. We don't know what, but he married Mary Jane Holmes. And this is part of the old Holmes Shipley farm, which I said Holmes Shipley, that's not true, part of the Shipley Holmes farm. he had 100 acres of land, and this is what it's called Kneebeck Hill. This is right outside the city of Philomath. And he is buried there. In 1863, he and his wife Mary Jane donated 100 acres of their property for a cemetery, with a stipulation that blacks could be buried there as well as whites. And if you know your history, it was not unusual for African Americans, as well as other people of color, to be banned from burying their deceased in white cemeteries. And so that stipulation worked, and so this, he is buried there with many of his descendants, and I'm proud to say many of my descendants are buried there as well. And this is a marker at the entrance of the cemetery, which you can't read, of course, basically just tells the history of the Shipley's Shipley's donating that property for a cemetery. And this is a marker in the Salem Memorial Cemetery. There's an organization in Oregon called the Oregon Black Pioneers, and they've done a lot of research on slaves and blacks in early Oregon, and they have put this marker that denotes all the blacks buried in what is now the Salem Pioneer Cemetery. Many of them buried without headstones. Robin Holmes is buried there, and so his name is on the marker, as are some of his children. Just a little bit about the massacre. Tonight at 9:00, the massacred story is going to be told on the Oregon Experience on OPB, and I've got my DVR set, so I'll be able to see it later. And this is the dedication of a Chinese memorial that a group of us installed in Hell's Canyon to the as many as 36 Chinese who were killed there by a gang of horse thieves. And this is Betty Luke lifting up the veil on this memorial marker. And Betty's also interviewed for this program tonight. I had dinner with her just the other night, a delightful lady out of Seattle. And her family is involved with what is known as the Asian Luke Museum in Seattle, which is a major Asian museum up there. And she had arranged, we had a committee, and she arranged for a Taoist priest to come up from Los Angeles to do the dedication. And the marker is in three languages, as you can see, Chinese and English, but also Nez Perce, because this is in Hell's Canyon, and these are Nez Perce lands. I try never to slip up and say former Nez Perce lands, because those lands were taken from the Nez Perce in a fraudulent treaty, and the Nez Perce were forced out of the Blau Valley. So anyway, we had a lot of participation from the Chinese community. And you can't see this from the river. This is actually high on a bluff. The river is down below here, and the memorial faces uphill. And the purpose is not to be there for tourists, but it's supposed to be just a nice marker to remember the Chinese who perished there. And there were a lot of touching moments in the dedication. This is the fifth year since we had the dedication. We're probably going to have another remembering event up there in Lewiston this year. But there were several really touching moments, and to me, this is one of the most touching. The fellow on the left is Charles Axtell, who was a Nez Perce elder from Lapwai. And that's Master Iman, who had come up from Los Angeles, the Taoist priest. And he is thanking Charles Axtell and the Nez Perce for allowing the Chinese to have a ceremony on their land. I thought it was such a touching moment, you know, to do that. And the Forest Service really helped us out, because this is the Hell's Canyon National Recreation Area. You're not supposed to do things like this in the canyon. All sorts of commercial activity is supposed to be banned. But we had a lot of help from the Forest Service, who made an exception, letting us put the memorial there. The site is now officially named Chinese Massacre Cove. We were allowed to have 150 people come up there, and that was pretty unusual too. So I'm really beholden to the Forest Service for their help on this. And there's some interesting Chinese, I don't know why I put all this in there, but there's some interesting Chinese memorials around the country. This is a new Chinese a memorial in Astoria, about 2 years old, right in downtown Astoria. And there were 2,000 Chinese who used to work in the cannery up there, and they're all gone now, of course. But this just remembers their participation there. And that's it, and thank you very, very much.